Section 4, Common Misconceptions About Mut'a Marriage. Misconception 1, Mut'a was a practice of the Arab ignorance era in which Islam had gradually cancelled and abrogated. This is absolutely false. Mut'a wasn't present in the Arab ignorance era at all. It was introduced and sanctioned by Islam in verse 424, as we have shown in previous sections. When we refer back to the history, we find that there were a few types of marriages at the ignorance era, and Mut'a is never mentioned as one of them. For example, it is narrated in Sahih Bukhari, chapter of marriage, page 1307, from Urwa ibn Zubayr from Aisha that she said, "The marriage in the ignorance era was four types." And then Aisha goes on to list them as the people's marriage, the marriage of istibda', the marriage of al-rahd, and the prostitutes. This hadith is also found in Sahih Sunan Abi Dawud for Al-Albani, part 7, pages 41 and 42, and in Sunan Al-Bayhaqi, part 7, pages 178 and 179. Two other marriages mentioned by historian Ibn al-Athir in his book Nihayat al-Lugha are al-Shighar marriage and al-Maqt marriage. Other marriages which have been mentioned are al-Badal, al-Mukhadana, and al-Mudamada. But nowhere we are able to find Mut'a marriage as one of the marriages of the Arab ignorance era. Misconception 2. There is no difference between Mut'a and Zina. This is false. Think of the example of halal meat versus haram meat. What is the difference between them? Can you taste the difference or smell the difference? Or is the fact that Allah has approved one and prohibited the other one a good enough reason for you to regard the two as different? The main difference is that Mut'a is a valid marriage approved by God. On the other hand, zina is forbidden and constitutes a major sin. There are also other differences. For example, in Mut'a there is a marriage contract and dowry which are both compulsory for the validity of the marriage and are both absent in zina. In Mut'a, if the marriage involved sexual intercourse, the wife is required to observe an iddah waiting period after the expiry of the marriage, similar to the situation of divorce. However, there is no iddah for zina. If a child is born from Mut'a, he is legitimate, he inherits, and the father is responsible for his provisions and sustenance, while this is not true in the case of zina. In Mut'a, there is an agreement and a code of conduct to refer to because it's an Islamic contract. But in zina, it's not even a contract. Therefore, breaches and transgressions can happen easily, as each party would impose their own moral code in the relationship. Misconception 3. You wouldn't accept Mut'a for your sister or daughter because it's only temporary. Firstly, by religion, I don't have the authority over my sister in this matter, so therefore I cannot interfere in her marriage. Secondly, if Allah and His Messenger accept something for her, then who am I to reject or accept? And how can I give myself the right to prohibit what Allah has made lawful or vice versa? I would accept it just like Allah and His Messenger have accepted it. Not to forget that the Sahaba have also accepted it for their women, like the example of Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr. If the sensitivity is about the temporary nature of Mut'a, then how is it different to the current permanent marriages where 50 to 70% of them end up becoming temporary due to divorce? Should these high divorce rates allow us to forbid divorce altogether just like the Catholics, even though Allah has sanctioned divorce as a lawful solution for society? Misconception 4. Mut'a could be contracted with married women. This ridiculous rumor has no basis whatsoever. Marriage to a married woman, dhatul ba'l, is absolutely forbidden regardless of the type of marriage, whether permanent or temporary. It is common knowledge that Islam only allows polygyny and never allows polyandry under any circumstances. This information is common knowledge and found in any basic fiqh books or any risala amaliyah. Misconception 5. Temporary marriage allows wastage and sampling, where people keep remarrying just to sample new spouses. This issue is not particular to temporary marriage. Even in permanent marriage, people can do serial marriages and divorces in order to sample new spouses. This doesn't mean we need to stop the institution of marriage altogether, but instead we need to combat the waster mentality. As Allah has said, the wasters are the brothers of the devil. 17:27. Misconception 6. Temporary marriage results in the abuse of women. According to Islam, marriage is always a voluntary process. Therefore, the voluntary consent of both contracting parties is an obligatory prerequisite for the validity of any Islamic marriage contract, whether permanent or temporary. This means no one can be blackmailed or forced into the situation or abused as a result of it, because both parties need to be transparent and open about the details of this marriage before they enter it, and both of them enter it voluntarily. Misconception 7. Mut'a marriage is similar to zina because mut'a doesn't require any witnesses. This is absolutely false. The issue of witnesses is not particular to temporary marriage. Even permanent marriage does not require any witnesses according to the school of Ahlul Bayt. In the school of Ahlul Bayt, it is only divorce that requires two witnesses, but marriage altogether does not require any witnesses, regardless of whether the marriage is permanent or temporary. The Sunni schools of thought say the exact opposite to this. They make it compulsory to have witnesses for marriage, and they do not require any witnesses for divorce. The opinion of Ahlul Bayt is in harmony with the Quran, which says two witnesses are required in the divorce process. This is mentioned in the Surah of Divorce, verse number 2, where it says, "And bring to witness two just men from among you and establish the testimony for Allah." The opinion of Ahlul Bayt is also in harmony with God's mercy and wisdom and is consistent with other Islamic laws. Putting conditions on things actually complicates them and lessens their occurrence. Allah does not want to complicate or reduce the occurrences of marriage, but He surely does want to reduce the number of divorces, as divorce is the most hated halal. Complicating the divorce process with the requirement of witnesses may cause the couple to reflect and reconsider their decision, but complicating marriage would just add to the number of fornicators. Another issue is that divorce involves many rights, settlements, and disputes, such as debt settlement, division of property, arrangement of child custody, arrangements of nafaqah during the iddah, recording the iddah period, deciding on the type of divorce, whether ba'in or revocable, and the interference of judges in many situations. Therefore, the requirement of witnesses is logically appropriate in the context of divorce rather than marriage. Misconception 8. Mut'a is zina because performing it doesn't require the permission of the wali. Once again, this is an ignorant statement and is absolutely false. In the Shia school of thought, the laws of the wali do not differ between temporary and permanent marriage. The same laws actually apply across both temporary and permanent marriages. If the potential wife is a virgin and under the age of rushd, then she needs the permission of the wali, which is her father or grandfather from her father's side. If she is not a virgin, then she does not require the permission of the wali. If she is a virgin but over the age of rushd, then some scholars like Muhammad Hussain Fadlullah, Sadiq Rouhani, and Gulpai Ghani say that she does not require the permission of the wali. And some other scholars say that she needs it as a precautionary measure. A precautionary verdict means that the scholar is uncertain about the verdict. So when a scholar gives a precautionary verdict, then there are two possible courses of action. One, to follow another scholar who has given a definite verdict which is not precautionary. In this case, it will mean that the permission is not required, as scholars Muhammad Hussain Fadlallah, Sadiq Rouhani, and Gulpai Ghani do not require the permission. Two, to take the precaution and ask the wali's permission before the marriage. The authority of the wali, however, is not absolute and is nullified in particular cases, namely, if the wali commits udul, which means to reject her marriage to the suitable person for anti-Islamic reasons, or if she is afraid from potential sin without this marriage, then the general law that overrides all the other laws says, no obedience for any creature in disobeying the Creator. These mentioned laws about the wali are applicable to both temporary and permanent marriages, and there is no difference between the two as far as the school of Ahlul Bayt is concerned. All this information is easily accessed in the jurisprudence books of the scholars of imitation, where they state their verdicts and conclusions. Misconception 9. Sunni schools of thought consider mut'a as zina. Many ignorant people, some of which label themselves as scholars, say that mut'a marriage is fornication, even though the Sunni schools are in agreement that mut'a cannot be labeled as fornication.
وصلكم هذا المرض زواج المتعة؟ زواج المتعة عند جمهور علماء السنة زنا والسلام زنا يشرعون الزنا كما في كتب.
Any marriage that is time bound, as in the case of the Shia marriage known as mut'a, this is not valid marriage. This isn't a valid marriage, and whoever participates in it would be actually committing zina or adultery.
وعلى هذا أجمع علماء المسلمين وأجمع أهل السنة على هذا وأن زواج المتعة زنا.
You know what muta is? Oh, maybe I didn't give you the definition. Muta is when someone commits zina with a woman as a prostitute in the name of a legal Islamic marriage. No more, no less. You commit zina, which they call muta, and then you do ghusl. MashaAllah, adhering to the teachings of Islam.
Zina.
الخلاف الفقهي هو أضعف أنواع الخلاف. أقل أنواع الخلاف تأثيرا ما بيننا وبين الشيعة هو الخلاف الفقهي، لأن الخلاف الفقهي قريب من اختلاف المذاهب بعضها وبعض المذاهب السنية. حتى يعني عندهم مثلا المتعة، المتعة دي قال بها يعني بعض علماء السنة، قال بها أصحاب ابن عباس، روي عن ابن عباس نفسه، وروي عن سعيد بن جبير، وروي عن عطاء وطاووس من أصحاب ابن عباس الكبار.
وفي ذلك المؤتمر أشهد الله وملائكته أنني سألت الشيخ القرضاوي، قلت نحن الآن في الغرب، قلت له جماهير من الشباب اليوم البلوغ مبكر والزواج متأخر، فماذا يفعلون في هذه المنطقة نو مانس لاند، منطقة الحرام أو المنطقة الحرام؟ فقال لي أشهد الله وملائكته إن المتعة حلال. 77.
وهذه أكبر جريمة. يعني أنتم تذكرون حتى كنا نتكلم على قضية وصف نكاح المتعة بأنه زنا، تكلمنا عنها قبل هذه الفترة، وقلنا مع أننا نقول بأنه نكاح المتعة باطل، لكن لا يصح أن تقول عنه أنه زنا. ليش؟ لأن الشرع أباحه في وقت من الأوقات، وما أباحه الشرع في أو وقت من الأوقات لا يمكن أن يكون فحشاء. إن الله لا يأمر بالفحشاء، لا يمكن أن يكون زنا أبدا، هذا غير مقبول تماما. إذا قلت إنه نكاح المتعة زنا، فأنت نسبت إلى الشرع أنه أباح الزنا والفحشاء في وقت من الأوقات، وهذا أشنع ما يكون. إذا قلت إنه نكاح المتعة زنا، فأنت نسبت إلى الشرع أنه أباح الزنا والفحشاء في وقت من الأوقات، وهذا أشنع ما يكون.
حد المتعة، نكاح المتعة، كل أهل السنة حقيقة يحرمونه، ولكن بالإجماع قالوا ليس زنا، ولكن بالإجماع قالوا ليس زنا، ولكن بالإجماع قالوا ليس زنا. يعني واحد تمتع بها لا يقام عليه العقوبة، ولا هي حرام، وهي حرام، لكن ليس إلى مرحلة الزنا. بس عقد فيه خلل، كما لو تزوج واحد زواج اعتيادي دائم فيه خلل معين. وزواج لا يدخل في نطاق الزنا بالإجماع، بإجماع المذاهب أن زواج المتعة ليس زنا. يعني يقول يا بطل أنا زوجتك من الساعة ساعتين، المذاهب الأربعة قالوا حرام لكنه مو زنا. يعني لهذا جماع، جماع زواج هو حرام فقط لأن صار به شرط التوقيت وليس زنا على أي حال، ولا يعاقب بعقوبة الزنا. حرام كما لو حكيت على واحد سبيته مثلا. أبو أحمد أنت لو تحصي كم واحد من المسلمين في العالم الإسلامي يمارس الزنا تذهل في هذا الزمان كما أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. هذا قل له يا أخي مكان مصدر الزنا تمتع بها متعة كحد أدنى، تدرأ الحدود بالشبهات، وبإجماع المسلمين الزنا ليس المتعة ليس زنا. إذن إذا شاع الزنا لا بل فليكن متعة. قل يا أخي سوي متعة بس لا تسويها، لا تحطها بالصيغة زوجته من الساعة ساعتين، لا خليه زوج هو خليه يطلق. زوجته من الساعة ساعتين، لا خليه زوج هو خليه يطلق.
Section 5 Instructions on how to perform a mut'a marriage. The process of contracting a mut'a marriage is very simple and does not require witnesses. If the girl is a virgin, then she would require the permission of the wali unless she is over the age of rushd. The age of rushd is defined as the age where the girl is able to manage her own financial affairs. The first step is to decide the dowry and the period of the marriage, and then the wording is read in Arabic as follows. The potential wife would start by saying, زوجتك نفسي في المدة المعلومة على المهر المعلوم, which means I married myself to you during the known period upon the known dowry. The potential husband replies, قبلت التزويج, which means I accepted the marriage. If they decide to end the period of the marriage before its designated expiry date, then the man is required to say وهبتك المدة, which means I forgave the rest of the period. At the conclusion of the marriage, if it was consummated, the wife needs to observe an iddah waiting period of 2 menstrual cycles, similar to divorce. This must be done before she is able to marry another man again. Nafaqa is not compulsory, and the husband and wife do not inherit each other, but any children produced from mut'a do inherit and have the same rights as the permanent married children.